when I got the email for two reasons. I mean, being with Tista and Deepa on stage by itself is another talking session, and we do a lot of that. The other, of course, is something that we all grapple with, we all talk about, and that's really on women and women-centric communication. Our brands doing it out of intent, really doing this to talk to women who are influencers and shoppers today, or is it just a tokenism? Because it's very good to make news and say that, you know, as a marketer and a brand, you are really interested. So without further ado, let me start with Tista and then Deepa, and it's free flowing, so both of you can jump in. What do you think your first-hand views on, is it tokenism today, or are brands really taking a step towards making meaningful women-centric communication?
So I'm going to answer that a little differently, which is the good thing is everybody is conscious that they must do something. The very bad thing is that people are doing it very, very badly. So are there conversations? Yes. Are there discussions? Yes. But does it translate into meaningful, making a difference kind of work? I would say no. Women's Day, women's issues, menstruation, domestic violence, the whole, I mean, there's so many issues. But so I don't know whether it's tokenism, but if you really want to solve or talk or connect and be relevant to women, what we're doing right now, I don't think is the right way to go about it.
Deepa?
Yeah, so I think obviously there would be a lot of tokenism because everybody's trying to make an effort, but I agree with Tista when I don't think this effort is totally directed at making a change as much as a lot of it is we need to make certain statements about our culture, our brand, what we believe in. So it seems more, you know, coming from that standpoint rather than is this really making a difference? Like if you see a lot of award juries also now, all kinds of entries, everybody seems to be solving women's problems. I'm not saying that's like a bad thing, but we've just got to do it better, do it right, and in a manner that it gets into culture rather than, you know, look at what I've done.
Yeah, true. So since, you know, both of you have mentioned that some brands are not really doing it right or not doing it okay, why do you think that's the case? And I would really like all of you, and Sanjeev, you are now a marketer, so also your perspective. What is it that stops brands from doing it the right way or maybe a better way?
Okay, I'm going to try and answer that. Because it's not that, like I said, we don't want to do it. But it makes a huge difference to begin with as to, I feel, who's around the table. And who's really, you know, calling the shots. It does matter. I firmly believe that it needn't be in-your-face change. And I do not think brands can do that. You cannot wake up one morning and say, starting today, we will just look at women differently and talk to them differently. It's far more subtle. It's far more gradual. It's slow. But women will get it. Just by showing a woman who's dressed differently and who's you know, being aggressive is just a no-no. So if you really want, and it comes back to your brand, and Deepan have been talking about it, your demographics, why is it that agencies and marketers and everybody around, you know, you're just talking to a woman. Now, who is she? Or you're talking to mothers, or you're talking to the working woman. But what do they feel? What do they? Why do they feel what they feel? Do they really feel other things? That kind of insight and that kind of understanding, I feel, is hugely lacking. We take the, you know, the fluff from the top and say, this is who she is. Let's talk to her. Oh yeah, she's a working woman, but she has to look after kids. No, what does she feel? Does she really, on days, does she really feel she doesn't want to probably look after her kids or to work? It could be either which way. But when we look at insights, when we go under the surface, that if you can hit on a sweet spot or something really powerful and build your communication around that, that I feel will make a big difference. Brands, we're too quick to agree and say, Eureka, we've got it and move on, as opposed to just spending a little time discussing, are we really getting it right or are we just doing it for the sake of doing it?
Yeah, Deepa, you want to add to that?
I think it actually starts, again, we were discussing this, at a briefing level itself. I think our mindset needs to start getting wired there. So I've done about 25 years in this business, and a lot of it on, you know, personal care and stuff. I find that whether it's with foods, whether it's with personal care, there is the brief, you know, the description of the woman you're talking to, it pretty much hasn't really evolved. So that it, you start in a slightly more cookie cutter place. So chances are whatever communication you're evolving from that cookie cutter space is going to be just that. You can't suddenly, you know, wake up and make a change. And I'm not talking about the communication which is out there making a statement. I'm talking about the, because I think it needs to be more cultural, more subtle, easier, and it should start in the more invisible lines, which are like, you know, how do you describe her? What does she do? So then automatically that subliminally, it's in your head when you're thinking about what work to put out. So I really think, yeah, that we should start it a little more back right there.
You know, it sort of makes you think, and I'm really talking to, you know, you here as well as to the panelists, that at the end of the day, brands want to create impact and influence because that is finally leading to commerce and equity. And yet, if this is the case, and all of us feel it, that it's a kind of a superficial understanding rather than going deep into what does a woman really want, to Tista's point. Is it just about a balanced life? Is it just about I want a job, but I also want my kids? Or is there something deeper that the brand can really talk to? Anyone here from the marketing fraternity or related to that who has a different point of view, you know, where you think that actually there's a lot being done, but we don't see it, or you feel that that is the case when it comes to a lot of brands?
Before we move it there, I just have a point. I think it's a start, Babita. It's not that they're being superficial or being...
It's a start,
Everybody's making a start.
Yes.
But maybe it's important to just think through
if
the start is just a spike, if the start is going to be a deeper
culture, or whether you see through
whether it's going to get culturally embedded. I think that is where maybe a bit more thinking and focus needs to be.
Okay. So is there anything before we move on to... you know, something else which is related to this.
I can say that communicating on women's issues is absolutely the need of the hour. I mean, whether it is superficial or not doesn't really make a difference, because if you are engaging with the women of the country, whether it's superficial issues, whether they're deeper issues, there must be real issues. That engagement is absolutely essential for marketers. For every brand, because the purchasing power of the woman in this country is increasing by leaps and bounds. So yes, there are issues which are possibly there is lip service paid to them, but even lip service has a certain value, I believe. And then there are, of course, deeper issues, and then there are, as Deepa, you said about making it a culture.
Yeah.
I think that's important, and that happens when you come up with something really insightful, something slightly deeper. And those things really work wonders. So I do believe that it's absolutely important and critical for brands, tokenism or not.
Yeah. Thank you. Tista, you want to?
I actually tend to disagree. We don't want lip service. It just like, you know, I mean, this is the first starting point of the conversation, which makes me terribly uncomfortable. Who are marketers and advertising and creative writers to decide that, hey, even lip service is good? No, we've had lip service forever. You've lip serviced us through the years of advertising. I think if that's the starting point, then there's no hope. Reverse it. Let's talk about things which really bother them. The lip service will come. Everybody's doing it. There are changes. Look at our lives. Look at departments in agencies and the marketer side. There are more women. But if the approach is going to be, even if it's lip service, you know, at least we're doing it. I just feel that. Then where are we going to go? Because doing the lip service part is easy. We get it. But if you really want to talk to us, and if you really want us to stay with your brand, and it's also, I'm talking about communication. It's not about, did we do it? Do I want to connect with the brand? Do I want to feel for you? Do I want to actually eventually go out and like purchase you? Then I'm not sure whether just lip service because somebody is doing it is good enough. But if you can talk to me, and that requires you know, time and skill and deeper thinking, but if you can get that right, I feel that's a far bigger battle one than just, you know, doing it instinctively.
Yeah. Maybe lip service is a wrong term. I think the point being made here, which I feel is correct, is even if it's a small step and seen by others to be, okay, they're doing it as a one-off, it's still a start. Because earlier the thought itself was not there, you know. So for example, a brand may be doing just one project a year, which is very, very woman-centric, and a lot of others would say, you know, but the rest of the year they do other things. I think that itself is a great starting point rather than not sort of doing anything at all. But you're right, find it has to become the way you work and the way you think, etc. Do you want to build on to this?
I'm not sure if it's enough to just say that not bad, at least it's a start.
Yeah.
Because I think if you just see, if you map history,
yeah,
right? Every generation of women maybe seems just better off compared to the previous generation.
Sure.
It's
yeah.
not really as a person. Like, you know, there was no first woman on the moon. Nations have had founding fathers, not founding mothers.
Yeah.
So there's been a reason why things have taken so long to yeah. get to where it is. But I really think it's important to just accelerate now. It's not about doing less, because otherwise you're going to be yet another part of the
right.
evolution, you know, bell
curve. The slow
curve,
pace of evolution,
is,
yeah.
And it has been very slow.
Yeah.
I mean, if you just look at history points, when could women vote? When could they open bank accounts? History tells you it's really slow.
Yeah.
So either we could be sitting here and talking about, yeah, let's make a start and let it evolve and go through its course of meandering.
Yeah.
Or you could say that if you're really serious, then it's a shift you need to make, not a start. And within that shift, you need to understand how you're doing it. You need yeah. to educate yourself on it. And that shift has to be part of, not maybe so provocatively done. Maybe you could do it provocatively, but I think shifts are typically when they happen as part of culture. So I think you have to see yourself more seamless than I'm standing out and I'm doing something. So
sure.
it just has to be deeper, but much, much faster, Babita. I can't bear the history.
Sure.
I enjoy
yeah,
doing
yeah,
that.
Yeah.
It's
okay.
like quite traumatic.
Yeah, okay. That's the timer, right? The thing. Okay. So we've got 25 minutes more. We'll move on to something which is related to this. That's the creators of such messaging, because messaging doesn't happen out of thin air. There are people who are sitting on either side of the table who are coming up with briefs, even before briefs, coming up with product innovations and then coming up with messaging, which brings me to the question here. Is it important to have... it's not a gender or a diversity ratio I'm talking about, but is it important to have an equal number of women voices on both sides? And do you think that itself will make a difference or does make a difference? So Tista first, and then we can go to Deepa or whichever.
So, like, absolutely. And again, it's not ratio and it's not percentages. But across, and I've worked with like so many women creative directors, they're friends of mine. Even in juries, I always feel that a woman's take on the same thing is always and always different. It's nuanced and it's textured, and there's a difference they bring to the table. So this is not about put 10 more women on the panel, no, not at all. But if you're really hearing women out on either side, and I'm talking about the creators of the communication, I'm talking about casting directors, I'm talking about women directors, I'm talking about women on the marketing side. If you want to really, and again we're coming back to, are we doing enough? There is a different point of view, not radical. The beauty of it is it's such a subtle shift, but you just say, uh-huh, yes, why are we looking at it like that? And I feel that's really important. So yes, have them, not because they're adding to numbers. No, we do not want representation around the table, but hear us on both sides, on every side, because you never know where, you know, the slightest in from them can actually make all the difference. And we can see that. I mean, I see it and I live it every day.
Deepa? I completely agree. I think have them for the texture, but and also have them because there is a larger comfort in expressing yourself, voicing what you feel. When you feel there are more like voices around you, you don't sort of kind of zip it and say, maybe I shouldn't, because majority voice on the table is thinking otherwise. So I think it's an absolute must. I'm seeing change in many places, but there again, are you doing it for its sake? Or are you doing it because you want to actually change texture of conversations, complexion? You know, you should want to do that. Otherwise, it's just a...
Yeah. So I'll just push you on this doing it for its sake, because I think that's the conversation where, you know, you have a conflict. That are people doing it because they're serious about it? Or are people doing it? We talked about lip service earlier. We talked about slow pace of change. What do you think really stands in the way of a marketing person or therefore people behind the brand to go whole hog out and say, you know what, let's go ahead and do it?
I think it's the understanding of the why. Why are you going to do this? Why do you want to have more voices? What do you want with your products? If you get into the why better, you will be able to solve for it better. If you just decide this needs to be done and, you know, starting tomorrow, there will be this many women on this brand. It's never going to work. So you have to figure out the problem that you're solving. And if there is no why, then there is no need. So yeah. I think that's the biggest thing you have to answer for yourself as a marketer, an advertiser, anybody.
Yeah. So do marketers, do you think, they feel that there is no need because if you look at data, maybe the spending power is still more with the men. Or maybe, you know, the money is better spent if we had to choose one protagonist for the for our communication. If that protagonist is a male protagonist, chances are we are anyway carpet bombing and we are not excluding a lot of people out who are actually holding the purses. So my point is, do you think business and data actually pushes people to work against the amount of work or the kind of work we are looking at for women?
Maybe, but I just feel if, again, if you go to the why, I think the role of communication is also to shape culture. It's not just to reflect, mirror, or do that. So I think you owe it. If you have a deeper reason why in your head, as a decision maker, wherever you're at, if you have a deeper belief system on the why, or if you really believe there needs to be, like, say, a more equal voice on the table, if you understand that, then you will also know it's your responsibility to shape culture, which means you may put out something there which your data may not support right now, but eventually you want the data to go there. So actually, you have to really know why you're doing it or for what, to what end you're doing it. It may be personal, it may be to sell something. There are multiple reasons why you do something.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I think to be a little more ahead may also be very good than to say, I'll just sit with, this is what data is currently saying, so let me just do what the current needs.
Sure.
I don't know.
Tista, you want to add to this?
No.
Anyone here, before we again go on to something which is more personal anecdotes or initiatives? Yeah, I see a hand. No, you'll get a mic.
There's a mic.
So all of us can hear you. If you can just tell us where you're from and your...
Sure. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Hi,
thank
my
you.
Name is Akash. I work with Star TV. So I'm in a team that markets Bollywood movies. So my question, to the team was that while, you know, the intent of the marketer possibly could be to make an initiative in that direction to probably make a difference or make a piece of communication. But for example, do you really feel that, because every marketing campaign honestly has an agenda or a marketing goal or a company goal at a larger scale, right? Do you really feel that without compromising on an organization or a communication goal, you can genuinely still make a shift? Because, I will not name the campaign, but I've been part of meetings. Previously, I was in an ad agency where we were trying to do something around a piece of communication where we wanted to go all out and recommend to a client that we should do something on ground where you have a face-to-face communication with women as an extension. But they said, you know what, no, we are in the business of, for example, entertainment. It's a piece of communication. The objective is for people to pick it up, talk about it, but that's where we'll stop. So do you feel that without compromising on objective business goals, you can still go ahead and make a difference for real?
So will one of you take it? Tista, Tista.
So, that's just the constant conundrum. I feel first, even as creative people, and, we are creative, Babita's worked on the other side, our first objective always is to the business objective. I mean, there's no question. We are not creating art for art's sake only to make a difference. And I get that. So is there an agenda? There should always be an agenda. There is a business imperative. Finally, I have to communicate so more people interact with my product, whether it's brand, whether it's a program, like you said. Having said that, I think how you communicate it, and that's where the question lies. Even if your primary goal is, like you said, there was a conversation saying, not the women. But therefore, can you tailor-make your communication in a way that doesn't denigrate them, doesn't make them bystanders, but shows them having a point of view. Because what we are not suggesting, and I don't think either of us are, that all brands start talking to women. No, there will be decisions which, of course, and that's part of our experience and understanding, and that's why you have marketeers and market leaders, etc. But somewhere, what bothers us is in your communication, even if it's that, where are the women and what role are they playing? Even if it's centered to a man making a decision, he's the protagonist, don't make her the bimbo who's the prop. That's all. That's all. I'm sure Babita, we talk about it. Some brands do it very smartly and weirdly. Should I talk about it now?
Yeah, sure. Go ahead.
Deepa and I were looking at Swiggy. Okay. I have no idea where Swiggy features and I don't agency, demographics, etc. But it is actually making the woman's, the mother's role redundant. We've grown up with brands telling us that her kitchen is her, the food on the table, children, oh my God, that's her glory. And it is. We've grown up. This is our culture, to talk about shift in culture. Yeah. But when Swiggy says, download your whatever, gajar ka halwa, whatever it is, and it stayed with me, weirdly stayed with her, and we spoke about it. Where the kids are normally groaning and saying, we don't like the food, real life. There's food on the table and the kids are like, gee, not nice. The husband is saying, why didn't you make this? Real life. And the woman says, yeah, sure. Here, order. And shows them the... Now, is it super fantastic? That's shift in culture. Because to have her traditional role, which is kitchen proud, home proud, dish proud, whatever proud, to say... go ahead and order it. I've had enough of you. All the nuancing below, I feel that is what we're talking about. Are you creating communication? It is layered. It's great writing. It's great casting. But more importantly, it's a really brave decision to say, remove the traditional bastion for women, which is where they were ruling, and show her that this is not all that makes you who you are. In a category which is food, which constantly shows... you know, big, perfect chapatis and puris and whatever, and all the children are happy and smiling. That's culture. But when you try to shift it and say, let's try it a little differently, because honestly, that is relevant. And that's what I meant by, that's real and that gets under my skin. Because suddenly you want to cheer for her and saying, yeah, I mean, you could be a housewife, but there are days you want to tell them, like, you know, tough luck, this is what I've done. And Swiggy's done it.
And I think what really stood out for both of us on that, and we were discussing this just yesterday, was the effortlessness with which it's done. It's not a big song and dance about it. It's just very matter of fact, very part of life, because it happens to... And why do we like it? Because I think every woman does think that she can't always be mum, making great food for family, wife, doing these wonderful things. You know, there is a time when you're not just a role, you are a person, and as a person you will have multiple decision swings at multiple points in time. So when a brand like puts it out there, and a food brand, you know, a food service brand puts it out there so effortlessly, that really shines, because then for us it's like part of culture. You do it quietly, effortlessly, and just get with the program.
Yeah, and I think it brings us to brand fit, and I'm glad you mentioned it. I think whenever the brand comes in with an effortless fit as a resolution. Because here it's like, I don't want to cook today. Go ahead and order. And that's what Swiggy does for business. It'll always be a success. I think where brands go wrong is there is no fit at times, but you just want to jump onto the bandwagon. Okay, it's Women's Day. Okay, it's Mother's Day. Let's do something. And then you feel that, oh my God, I mean, does it even make sense? I'll tell you, when the Swiggy ad was posted, there were a lot of comments on, okay, is that promoting unhealthy eating? Does that mean women of India now stop cooking? And I actually read that and I thought, wow, these are things that actually make a culture change. If you don't have comments like that, that means it hasn't cut ice. And so those comments should never be seen by either the marketer or the advertising agency as, oh my God, we've got negative comments now. It'll sort of mar the reputation of the brand. Let's not get into it. That's where the boldness comes in to say the brave are the ones who take comments in the stride, so long as it's not negative on the brand itself, and then move on with it. So thank you. Does that answer your question?
It's not a question, but and we honestly couldn't think of brands.
But okay, yeah, cool. And also we talked about whether we talk brands or not, so it's okay.
I'm talking about Nike, which everybody is familiar with, and you know they get it so fantastically right all the time. But this, and it's always been about women and sport and grit, and you can do it. And everybody knows it. I don't want to preach to the choir. But their recent, and I think, Babita, you touched upon it in your previous session. Their current communication, which says, scream, be irrational. You know, they'll call you crazy. They'll call you... Why is even a brand like that, which has spoken about, yes, you can do it, and, you know, you've got the power, is saying, you're actually crazy, and you're a misfit, and people will label you. But you know what? You are still who you are. That for me is again a shift in culture from communication, which has always been women oriented and they do it brilliantly. But suddenly somebody is saying, hey, let's touch upon that, because as women, that's the first label you get. Like, why are you talking so loud? Like, what's wrong with you? Yeah, perpetually. And then the next thing is, have you got your period?
Yeah, I'm hormonal. Yeah.
But the truth is, we do get our period. We do get crazy. And we can be irrational. The sad thing is, so can the men. Yeah. But they're only asking us that. So, yeah.
Yeah, true. Tista, Anant mentioned, for those of you who were there in the earlier panel, Anant mentioned the collective. And I think it's a right time to talk about, and Anant also mentioned what started off as a response to harassment went on to something which is actually far more than that, into bringing women and issues into the limelight. So would you like to talk about that?
Deepa,
yeah.
Start.
So collective, we're 12 women currently. And I'm saying 12 women because these are the founding members. Collective started with an innocuous article about the advertising industry. We're not talking to clients and marketers as yet. We're women. It began with women really feeling unsafe in the environment they're in. And all of us who've grown up in this industry, which we love, and that's why we're here on a working day talking about issues, felt collectively we had to do something. So I want to talk about two things, who we are and what we do. Who we are, we belong to different agencies. In our professional lives, we are pitted against each other. We are totally agency agnostic. We are 12 of us from design and advertising. That's who we are. We come together, we meet often, we fight a lot, we laugh, we discuss things. What do we want to do? We want, and I really mean it sincerely, to make our industry where we began our careers and what we love about the industry. Recently, we've been feeling and reading and seeing a lot of stuff happening in within agencies, within digital agencies, within design houses, where women, even men, are beginning to feel uncomfortable. There's a lot of things which were brushed under the carpet, which women felt they couldn't talk about. So our endeavor, and it starts, of course, harassment is a big key, but our endeavor is so much a part of what this panel has been, to talk to, hopefully tomorrow with clients, to talk about how are your women feeling, how is your communication tailored to women, what can you do, what can't you do, and also basic hygiene in terms of, you know, what's permissible and what's not. We are not judge, we are not jury, we are not naming, we are not shaming. But we want every woman to feel that, you know, here's a place where you can make your career. I mean, we have. And honestly, bring back the passion and the joy of what advertising is really all about.
I think
okay. Deepa?
Covered it well.
Okay.
Yeah, so we'd really welcome if anyone has any questions, anything. You should reach out to the collective. And we are not aligned to an agency. It's really an agnostic. It's 12 people who felt about something that we've sort of... and we've spent so much time that we do think we have some collective wisdom between the 12 of us to be able to maybe guide, counsel, and even just create, work towards a better culture for women in the workplace.
Okay. So just one last question. I actually thought about it now. If you had to form an all-women's agency tomorrow, would you do it? And would you get business?
I would always go to the why first. So if you're asking if I would, yeah. But I would, before I say yes or no...
But would you want to?
I would think through why. Yeah, I don't know. I really don't think I have thought it through to think, okay. Should it be all boys, all girls? I think... For me, the moment I start feeling there's either a, you know, gender limitation or a gender advantage, in my head the math doesn't add up.
Okay.
So I will answer this if I've thought through on the why. Okay. Why am I starting a business? Yeah. Do I want it to be all women? Do I want to earn or do I want to do something else? Okay. Do I want to learn? I don't know. And then I would maybe answer.
Okay. All right. Tista, is it a different answer?
No, but I'm just talking about teams within the agency. I really want to start my own business, but I don't have the guts. But
well, that's speaking for a lot of us.
I'm saying within the agency, and we do it. When there are more clusters of women teams, which is, I'm seeing it a lot from my client side, I'm seeing it from the agency side, then somewhere, and not, it's not like only women, but even if I'm talking to women directors, I do see that the first discussion with a woman director goes in one direction, and another discussion with any talent, it's not about talent, but their perception or their perspective of the script changes. So I feel, yes, an all-women alliance, so to speak, can make a difference. And tomorrow, if there's a client who tells me, I will pay you three times your salary. If you have an all-women team, I'll do it. Yeah, I won't think so.
Okay. All right. So we've got 8 minutes. So let's open it up. Great question there. Thank you, Sanjeev. But anybody else? Not a but. Anybody else? And please, one hand up.
Yeah, hi. I think the collective is a very inspiring platform and concept in itself, because we really want to break up the boys' club. And as a concept, this one really gives a lot of hope to other women. How important do you think it is for more and more professional women to network within amongst each other, to pool their talents, and to form, as you have formed, like the collective?
Like, exceedingly important. I think, Ogilvy has these young girls who've started this thing called Indian Creative Directors, Women Creative Leaders. And they organized a forum. They're just amazing, these young. And they organized a forum where they brought all of us together, because usually, when do we all come together? For a networking evening where we had a discussion, and then we had a drink and we chatted. And it just felt so empowering, because we've never done it before. And I completely agree. It is so important that we do our own bit as well. There's always the drink at the watering hole after a pitch or a long day at work, and that happens, and it's important to do it. But if women can do a little huddle, so to speak, a networking huddle, because sometimes a lot of the conversation is things which you normally wouldn't really have back there. I'm stressing again on it. If you feel there is change and there is something you want to, you want to be a part of. So you need to believe that women together can do something, and it's fun. This is not like a court of law where it's all agony.
I think
agony.
It was a really nice evening after a very long time. So it's just super important.
And we spoke about advertising and design and insights, and it was very heavy. And then we opened it up to the audience, only women, about 50 women. And then the first question we took was from this girl, and she said, should I get married? And we all burst out. We were like, what? I mean, but that's women networking.
That's important.
She was coming from work, from culture, from husband, long hours, in-laws. But that's what women feel. So we're talking about this heavy duty, we are so good, and we have it all. And she's like, should I get married? Should I say yes to him? And then we all ended up discussing it. I hope she got married eventually. But it was, but that's it. That's the difference that it happened.
I think she was genuinely talking about a balancing of cultures, her cultural background and the culture at work, which is what she'd been exposed to for, let's say, the last few years. So I don't know if she was very comfortable in that open forum discussing the, the cultural shifts that she's got to make, and how does she process and filter it into one. I think had it been any other forum, larger, smaller, mixed, she may not have been able to talk about it, and nor may she have got so many points of view on it.
Yeah. Does that answer your question? Okay. Anybody else? Any more questions? No? Okay. So let's end this session. Thank you so much, Tista, Deepa. Thank you, Anand. Thank you, Zee MELT. It was fantastic moderating this. Thank you.
Thank you.
And thank you, Babita.